In the previous video, we saw that for the task of tracking a trajectory with a constant velocity, a proportional controller results in non-zero steady-state error, C over KP. To fix this, let's augment the P controller with another term that is proportional to the integral of the error over time. KI is called the integral gain since it multiplies the time integral of the error. We can calculate this time integral numerically in the control computer. We call this new controller proportional integral control, or PI control for short. Plugging this controller into the error dynamics, we get this equation for the time evolution of the error. To turn it into a differential equation, we can take the derivatives of both sides. We now have a standard second-order homogeneous differential equation, where the damping ratio is Kp over 2 times the square root of Ki, and the natural frequency is the square root of Ki. By our mass spring damper analogy from earlier videos, Ki plays the role of the spring and Kp plays the role of the damper. If Ki and Kp are both positive, then the error dynamics are stable and the steady state error is zero. In other words, the commanded velocity is non-zero when the error is zero because the integral of the error is not zero. The characteristic equation of the error dynamics is S squared plus Kps plus Ki equals zero, which means the roots are given by this equation. We can plot these roots in the complex plane. Here, the roots marked 1 correspond to overdamped error dynamics, where Kp is large relative to Ki. Here's a plot of the overdamped error response. If we increase the gain Ki until it equals Kp squared over 4, so that the term in the square root is 0, we get a critically damped response, indicated as 2. Increasing the gain Ki pushes the two roots toward each other until critical damping, where both roots are located at minus Kp over 2. Note that the critically damped response is faster than the overdamped response. If we continue to increase the gain Ki, the term in the square root becomes negative, and the two roots become complex conjugates, moving away from each other in the vertical direction. The new roots and the new response are marked 3. Since the real values of the roots are unchanged, the settling time is unchanged, but we now see overshoot and oscillation in the error response. Of the three error responses, the critically damped response, marked 2, is the best since it is fast and has no overshoot. In general, critical damping is a good goal for second-order error dynamics. The path that the two roots trace as we change the control gain Ki is called a root locus. A root locus plots the roots as we change a single parameter, such as the gain Ki in this example. We can use the root locus to help us choose control gains. We would like to keep the roots far to the left for fast settling and close to the real axis to minimize overshoot. As discussed before, though, there are limits as to how large we can choose the gains. Let's look at an example of P and PI control applied to tracking a trajectory with a constant velocity. The dashed line represents the desired position theta d as a function of time. The actual initial position, theta at time 0, has some error, as shown by the dot. The P controller by itself cannot track the trajectory. In steady state, it always lags behind the desired position by C over Kp, as we calculated earlier. We can also see this in the error response. On the other hand, if we add an integral term, we see the PI controller achieves zero steady state error. Here we've chosen the PI controller to be underdamped. A better PI controller would eliminate overshoot and achieve critical damping by choosing a lower gain Ki or a larger gain Kp. In summary, P control eliminates steady state error for set point control, and PI control eliminates steady state error for any trajectory with constant velocity. A PI controller cannot eliminate steady state error for arbitrary trajectories, but a properly tuned PI controller should provide good tracking for many practical trajectories. A PI control system can be visualized as a block diagram, as shown here. The actual position is subtracted from the reference position to get the error, and this error is multiplied by the gain Kp and integrated and multiplied by the gain Ki. These terms are then summed to produce the commanded joint velocity. The robot moves and a sensor returns the actual position to the controller. One problem with this control law is that the robot never moves until there is an error to force it to move. Since we know the desired trajectory, we should be able to move the robot without waiting for error to accumulate. We can augment this control law by adding a feedforward term. If the error is zero, the commanded velocity is just the desired velocity. This is our final preferred control law if the commanded controls are velocities. Until now, we've been discussing a robot with a single joint, but the control law is unchanged for a multi-joint robot. Each joint has the same control law governing it. We can write the scalar equation for each joint as a single vector equation by treating theta, theta d, and theta e as vectors, and treating kp and ki each as an identity matrix times a positive scalar. The control law I've just described is expressed in terms of joint trajectories, but sometimes it's more convenient to express the desired motion in terms of the motion of the end effector. This leads to task space motion control, the topic of the next video.